All right, this is the fourth and one. I guess this is episode 3. We're doing a Super Bowl recap today. Guest host today is Tyler, and I guess we need to start off by announcing, you know, you're
acknowledging the elephant in the room.
You're a huge Patriots fan.
I am biased. If you're a Patriots fan, you're gonna, or if you're a Patriots hater, you're gonna hate this podcast. But you're gonna learn some things.
Yeah. Shout out to Tim Hortons today. It's Roll at the Rim today.
Yep.
So I guess let's get right into it with our quarterback comparison. And so I'm going to go ahead right now and say Tom Brady, the greatest quarterback of all time, no questions asked.
I didn't think, coming into this, I always thought he was number one. Yeah. After Super Bowl 49, everyone forgets that. At the time, that was the biggest comeback in Super Bowl history.
But you could always make the argument that Joe Montana was tied with him there because they both had four Super Bowls.
Montana was a more clutch Super Bowl performer.
Right.
At the time, I would give him that. Brady had his moments, but again, he lost twice.
But now with five Super Bowls, it's pretty clear.
It's over.
Tom Brady has more Super Bowls than like 20 teams in the league and more Super Bowls than 13 teams combined.
He won... I heard this stat. It's crazy. He's won 10% of every Super Bowl that's played.
5 out of 51 is
close.
Pretty much, yeah.
Pretty much. We'll give him it.
Yeah.
Insane.
So let's look at the stats here. Tom Brady was 43 of 62, so like 66% passing. 466 yards. 266 came in the fourth quarter.
And that could have been higher. He missed a few passes. Let's get out of the way. First quarter, did not look like Tom Brady.
No.
Second quarter, though, is when he turned it on, and there was a few drops. Chris Hogan had the big one, and Edelman had a big one.
Now, back to the first quarter for a second. Do you know the Patriots haven't scored a point in the first quarter of any of their Super Bowls?
I do know that, and it's crazy.
It's an amazing... That's like the weirdest stat. Like, normally the team that scores first wins, but the Patriots have never scored first.
Yeah, if you look at their Super Bowls, all seven of them... Or not all seven of them. The wins, pretty much.
All five
they were
wins.
High-scoring games, except the first one, the Rams win. 32 they scored, 24 they scored, 28 they scored, and 34 they scored.
Yeah.
First quarter, optional.
Yeah.
Optional.
they only play three quarters.
Apparently so.
He's so great, he only needs three. He had two touchdowns, one pick, and obviously the pick was...
It was a big one.
The pick six, I mean, that's massive.
You got to give credit to Atlanta on that one. They read that play.
And a 95.2 rating. I don't know how much you believe in... I know you're not really a huge into the whole ratings bit, but I think...
I like how when Brady's ratings are high.
I love the ratings as a stat. That's one of my favorite stats.
Do you know who had the highest rating of all time for a Super Bowl loser?
Let me guess. It was Tom Brady.
No, it was Matt Ryan.
Oh, really?
Matt Ryan.
Okay, so now we're going to flip over to the Falcons for a sec. We'll look at Matt Ryan's stats here. 17 of 23... That's insane.
Matt Ryan played good.
He only missed six passes.
Yep.
Okay. 284 yards, two touchdowns, no picks, and a 144.1 rating. I mean, those are really good numbers, but, like, I mean, he only had two touchdowns. As a team, they really only scored, like, two touchdowns. 14 of the Falcons' points came off turnovers.
14 points on their own accord.
Yeah. 14 points from their own drives.
Yeah.
And then 14 points from Patriots miscues.
Like that LeGarrette Blunt fumble. That was big.
It was
0-0.
And even if you want to take that fumble as a Falcons moving the ball on their own accord.
Only 21.
That's still 21 points and not 28. So you can't really say that, you know, the great Falcons offense.
Yeah.
I mean, this really shows, and this is my take from the game. It shows two things for me. The mastery game planning of Bill Belichick.
Yep.
And the greatness at quarterback of Tom Brady.
You got to throw one more name in there. Big Matt Patricia.
Matt Patricia.
He's a Bill Belichick student. We get that. Bill, he's learned from the best.
Yep.
Patricia has his boys going.
Yep.
When I watch every single Patriots game. When I heard they finished the year the number one defense, I was shocked.
No, number one scoring defense.
I was shocked. They don't really have all the big names. They have good players. Dante Hightower's a big name.
They've got a couple A's and then a lot of like B minus C plus guys.
But they have guys who do their job.
Way to quote Bill Belichick.
And it's really just the Patriot way. Like Jamie Collins, he was a big name. We give him Collins.
The man banished to Cleveland.
Yeah.
How does he feel now?
Not good.
Okay, he asked for $2 million more than Bill Belichick wanted to give him.
And not
he got
just,
banished in Cleveland and then watch his team win the Super Bowl.
There were some things that came out after the trade that came up.
Yeah.
Apparently the one, again, I wasn't there. I'm a big fan, but I wasn't in the locker room, believe it or not. But I heard there was a video session, and one of the coaches said, Jamie, like, you have to get your nose in on that play. You got to jump that quicker.
Yeah.
And reportedly what he said is, I don't get paid enough to do that.
Yeah.
You might as well just tell Belichick he fucked his wife at that point.
Whoa, what was the F-bomb there, sir?
Oh, sorry.
We try and keep this under an R rating.
At that point, he pretty much told Belichick, I am not a New England Patriot player.
Yeah. I'm not buying into your system here.
Exactly.
So let's talk about running backs for a little bit here. And I really was surprised at how the Falcons used their running backs. I mean,
New England was too, I think.
Yeah, I mean, okay, so the lead New England running back was James White, not LeGarrette Blount.
I was surprised. I thought New England, I think I told you this before the game, my prediction for them was they want to bleed the clock.
Yep.
They did it, but not by LeGarrette Blount. By throwing it 60 bloody times. LeGarrette Blount, non-factor.
Well, once he had the fumble, he's sitting in Belichick's doghouse. Yep. And
Atlanta was faster than I thought. Like, Blount, he's not a...
He's not a speed. He's a power
back. He needs to get to the hole first.
Yep.
There is no getting to the hole first. Atlanta shut Blount down. And I did not see that coming.
But so James White had 6 carries, 29 yards. So a 4.8 average, two touchdowns.
And
no fumbles.
2-point conversion. They did the direct snap.
Oh, that was
him.
Yeah, yeah. Yep. Meanwhile, Devonta Freeman on the other side, he was their top back. He had 11 carries, 75 yards, 6.8 per carry, one touchdown.
And not to shovel on Shanahan more, because he's getting it, deservedly so. If they play Freeman right the second half, he might be your Super Bowl MVP. The guy was...
A monster.
Yeah.
Yep.
And when they were backed up, I believe it was 28-20 at that time, New England pinned Atlanta.
Yep.
The first play was, a 36-yard pass to Freeman?
Yeah. Now, I see the stats here, 11 carries for 75 yards. But I want to bring up, and I know people might not like this, but I'm a believer in advanced metrics and fancy stats. Uh-huh. And I know some people aren't. Some people think fancy stats are for idiots. But Devonta Freeman had 11 carries, but not all of those carries were positive yards. Like, he had people say, "Oh, but why wouldn't you run the ball? We had a running back
with 6 points.
He had a 6.8 yards per carry." But a lot of those runs that got him all those yards, those are big yardage runs.
Yeah.
Those were, he had a couple of runs that were very large runs, and then a whole bunch of runs that were either 0 yards or negative yards.
I agree with you. There was one time it was inexcusable not to run him. 28-20, right after the Julio Jones miraculous catch.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So they run him at first one. He gets lost for a yard. Yeah. Second and 11. I don't give... you run him again.
Yes.
You take another 2-yard loss. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Instead, that was the sack play.
Yeah.
And Matt Ryan, he played great.
Yeah.
Matt Ryan played great. That was inexcusable for him to take that sack.
Definitely.
The play call was bad. Him getting sacked, just as bad, if not worse.
The play call is a horrible play call. But if you're an elite quarterback...
He won the MVP, and deservedly so.
If you want to be elite, you have to throw it away there.
Can't take that sack. And he had time.
You cannot take it.
The one where people were ripping on him a bit, undeservedly so, I think, was the fumble. Hightower.
Yeah.
Or the game MVP, who I thought could have been Freeman, just gagged that block.
Yeah.
Horrible.
But so, like, I wanted to point out there for the second about, like, the fancy stats that people said. People talked about, like, the play calling that, why didn't they use their 6.8-yard averaging running back? But, like, he really wasn't averaging 6.8 a carry.
Yeah.
He had a couple huge runs and then a bunch of runs that were zero or negative
and
yards.
That's New England adjusted to that at
right,
halftime.
Right, right. And so...
Hightower, he's a linebacker. He was coming off the edge. He was going everywhere.
But so the point I'm trying to make, though, is when people are saying, why wouldn't they have used their big running back more? Well, because he wasn't as effective as people were thinking. The stats look great.
Yeah.
But the stats don't tell the whole story, which is why you got to go to my favorite thing, fancy stats.
I agree with you up until that final drive. That final drive was inexcusable.
Total, yeah.
And then the third down play. Instead of running a screen pass, and because Matt Bryant is one of the best field goal kickers.
Any zero yard play is okay there.
Yeah. Instead, they took the holding call.
Yeah.
And there's wishy-washy calls. That was not one of them.
A better play call for that spot would have been taking a knee. Would have been better.
Yep. Do you know who rushed the QB and they had to hold him, who got forced that play?
Was it Rob Ninkovich?
Nope. Chris Long. The veteran.
Oh, the savvy veteran.
Yep.
Yeah.
Who came from the St. Louis Rams when they were averaging 4 wins a year.
Yep.
He takes a huge pay cut, comes to the Patriots. He did his job.
He did.
All right.
Okay.
But again, Chris Long was great.
Yeah, and you know, he finally gets that elusive Super Bowl that's evaded him for his whole career because he was forced to play with the Rams.
And there's one thing that's almost going under the radar, and it's a good thing.
Yeah.
Did you ever see a call in that game when you were like, oh, that was a horrible call?
There were a couple calls where I thought they were a little soft, but there was nothing where
maybe
I was
on
like
the Patriot.
There was a couple PIs that I thought were either soft or missed off calls.
When New England got three first downs in a row on the holding,
yes,
one of them was a phantom call, 100%. But again, that ended with the pick six. So
right,
and the one call too, which was a horrible call, Shea McKellen.
Yep.
Remember, we were at you. We actually went to a Patriots
game
this
year. Disclosure there. We went and saw the Ravens at Patriots.
Justin Tucker missed his first field goal. How?
Wasn't it a block?
By Shea McKellen, who jumped the line. He did
right.
it again on the extra point.
Yeah.
They called him on a penalty, I'm not going to pretend I know that rule. It was a pretty obscure rule.
So the way it works is, so when you're jumping the center like that, you can't touch the center, and you can't actually go right
over
him.
The center.
You have to go over the
A
gap.
And Bill Belichick was saying he hit the gap. He hit
if you look at the replay,
he hit the gap.
He did hit the gap, and it's kind of a little.
But regardless, if that's the worst call in the game, those refs did a fantastic job.
And there was controversy about that because Carl Cheppers, the head referee, he was the one who had the holding call on Travis Kelce in the divisional round game. And people were concerned that he was going to, like, interfere in how the game was being called.
You didn't know that was the correct call, but...
It was a good call
there.
Did
you like that call?
I did.
Yeah.
But people were all concerned that, like, you know, is he going to interject the refereeing into the game? And is he there... Should they have maybe gone with Ed Hockley or one of those more senior refs? But I think he did a great job, and the refing couldn't complain about that.
And so we're still technically on the running back.
We still are on running back.
I got to ask you something. Was James White robbed of the MVP?
No.
Robbed is a ridiculous word. What? Like, come on.
Okay, let's not.
I heard some people were saying that.
Okay, so the only reason people are even talking about James White being MVP is because Tom Brady said James White should be the MVP.
But that's not
saying James White didn't deserve it.
Yes.
It's just that
Tom Brady was
the MVP, and he's very modest about himself.
If James White would have won the MVP, I wouldn't have said Tom Brady was robbed.
No.
I would have said I thought Tom Brady was the MVP.
Yeah.
So if you think James White was the MVP,
That's fine.
But to say he was robbed.
Yeah.
You
can make an argument for him.
Yep.
But you can make an equally as great argument for Tom Brady.
That was like Super Bowl 49. I actually thought maybe Julian Edelman was going
to
get it.
But instead it went to Malcolm Butler, right?
No, it went to Tom Brady. Some people were saying Butler.
It should have been Butler.
Could have. One play. Okay.
But it was a goal line touchdown interception.
It was, but at the time. That was the biggest Super Bowl comeback
of all time, until this time.
That is something else.
So I think it's time we move over to receivers.
Should start with Julio Jones.
Wrong. He actually wasn't their top receiver.
Who was their top receiver? Freeman?
The Falcons' top receiver was actually Austin Hooper.
No, that's just a touchdown, though, right? Not yards.
So 3 catches, 6 targets, 37 yards, and a touchdown.
Okay.
Team stats-wise, though... Julio Jones had 4 catches for 87 yards.
If you would have told me before the game, don't tell me the score, nothing. You show me Julio Jones' stat line, 4 catches for 87 yards.
Yeah.
I'm saying Patriots win that game.
Yeah. If you can hold Julio Jones under 100 and no touchdown, that's
the job well done.
Yeah.
And one thing, okay, there's one player. Do you know how in like hockey, there's always a guy in the locker room the coach takes his frustrations out on.
Yeah.
He's the whipping boy.
Yeah.
I had my own New England Patriots whipping boy.
Who's that?
Logan Ryan.
You hate the guy.
I am eating some humble pie. Well, no, because I'm happy they won.
Yeah.
But he showed up big in the playoffs.
Yeah.
But just whenever it seemed there was a third down and 10, and they...
There's Julio Jones.
Yeah.
Coming up with a catch.
Just throughout the season, last season, all that... Whenever there was whatever reason, it always seemed to be Logan Ryan.
Yep.
And, yeah, but...
So, now, fun question here. Who is the Patriots' top receiver?
James White.
And, wrong.
It was, though.
But it's not. It's Danny Amendola. 8 catches on 11 targets, 78 yards and a touchdown.
But, like, what stats are you using to say he was number one? Because James White had...
Well, if you actually want to know how you...
Unless you're talking about fantasy points, is that what you're going on?
Well, no, but points is... When you track the best players, you're looking at touchdowns first and yards second.
But James
because points, because touchdowns is points on the board, Yards doesn't necessarily mean that.
Amendola and James White each had a touchdown.
I'm telling you here, the matchup tracker shows the top receiver is Danny Amendola.
Okay. Let's talk about Danny Amendola.
My fancy stats tracker here.
Can we talk about Danny Amendola then?
Okay.
All year, this guy is the most, just encompasses the Patriot way.
He's such a workhorse.
He is a workhorse. This year, he was dealing with injuries.
Yep.
When he first signed in New England, he was supposed to be their number one guy. Yep.
And it never materialized.
Wes Welker wasn't supposed to be replaced by Julian Edelman.
No. Nope.
He was supposed to be replaced by Danny Amendola.
Yep.
For whatever reason, Amendola did have injuries. We got to give him that.
Yep.
He was probably never supposed to be a number one wide receiver.
Yep.
He did kind of get paid like one, but he restructured.
Mm-hmm.
Going back to Super Bowl 49, he caught a touchdown pass. And this game, so he got the touchdown, right?
Yeah.
Talked about that. I think he had two big third down conversions. And the big one, 28-26. They need a two-point conversion to win.
Yep.
They throw him that little bubble hitch.
Yep, I love it.
Unbelievable.
It's great. So now you say James White was the number one receiver. He had 14 catches, 110 yards, and a touchdown. And I actually don't understand. I'm looking at all the stats here, and it doesn't make sense why
Amendola is ahead of
him. But again,
both of them just balled out.
Great game on both of them. But I actually think the most important New England receiver.
Let me guess, Julian Edelman?
No. Malcolm Mitchell.
Malcolm. Okay. Yeah.
Right. Because there was a string of there was a string on one of the drives in late in the third quarter where Malcolm Mitchell had four or five consecutive passes. They weren't huge catches, but he was Tom Brady's go-to element on that drive. And I think that is the drive at the end of the third quarter that really sparked Tom Brady and that offense to start moving forward.
And another wide receiver who had a big game, not number-wise, but there was a play down 28-20.
Chris Hogan?
Chris Hogan.
Chris Hogan. 28-20,
they started at their, it was a big punt.
Yep.
So New England was pinned.
I think it was on the 15, I think.
Could have been. So 28-20, the first two plays were incomplete passes.
Yep.
So it was a third down, and it might have been, it was smaller than the 15, because Brady threw that ball out of the end zone.
Yep.
It was third and 10, and he threw a 15-yard dart to Chris Hogan.
That's right, I remember that. Hogan. It was on the 5, that's right. Yep. Yeah. It was the pinned punt on the 5, that's right. Now, talking about Chris Hogan stats, nothing really special here. I mean, 4 catches, 57 yards, no touchdowns. Oh. But all of his catches were like pivotal, like clutch in the moment catches.
Yeah. Chris Hogan had a big game.
You know who I think had a huge game? Bennett there, Martellus Bennett.
Martellus Bennett. Yep. He probably should have had the game winning touchdown in overtime.
5 catches for 62 yards.
Remember 28-28.
But it's also a super risky pass on Tom Brady to float that one in there.
Yep. But it did set him up at the 1.
It did. Yeah. Yeah.
But that, I remember screaming, Bennett dropped it, and then the flag's down. What's the flag? Oh, it was P.I. There's a reason why he dropped it.
I know whenever me and you watch football, and we watch football a lot, you'll watch a play, and you'll get all angry about a play happening, and I'll be like, hang on a sec here, there's a flag.
Yeah.
and then you'll sit down, and you'll like start playing with the TV trying to figure it out. When we're watching the
Super Bowl, apparently this was my reaction. I was up a lot, like leaning forward. Then, oh, they screwed up, and then I found out it was a flag, and I popped right back up.
Yeah, sometimes you have a tendency to overreact just a little bit.
But okay, since we're talking wide receivers still, we got to go to Julian Edelman in that catch, do we not? Oh my God.
I'm just not a fan of Julian Edelman as a player, just in
general. Are you insane?
I find that people, he's given too much credit. Like, I
think he gets not enough credit.
I don't think he's as good as people think he is. I think he's a product of Tom Brady.
I think if you put him on any other team, he's not a number one within reason. There's a few crappy teams.
I think he's barely a two on a lot of teams.
Oh, that is insane. Come on. Stop. Are you really?
He's a punt returner.
Yeah. Antonio Brown is too.
Yep. Name me another receiver on that team that can punt return.
On who?
On the Steelers.
I don't know.
Exactly. Yeah.
But I will go back. If you look at Julian Edelman's stats in the playoffs, he is unreal.
They're on fire.
And I agree. Brady makes Edelman better.
5 catches for 87 yards.
Yeah, and he was actually bigger in Super Bowl 49, where I said, again, he could have
had the MVP.
He could have won the MVP in Super Bowl 49. And since we're on Edelman, the one play where I just thought they were conceding, when they did you see when Edelman threw the pass?
Yes.
That was such desperation. I didn't like it.
But it's Patriot-esque because that's almost their flea flicker play. Yeah. And
at that point, like, I thought they were going to lose. It was when
it was 28-3 at halftime, did you think there was 21-3. Sorry. Yeah. 21-3 at halftime. Did you think there was any possible way they could come back?
Yes, but when it got to 28-3.
At halftime, I was thinking, okay, 21-3. They just need three touchdowns. They'll win 24-21. They've got a pretty good defense. Yeah. They can hold. And then the Falcons open up the second and score that touchdown. And
Atlanta actually, I believe they went a 3-and-out, opened it, went back to New England in a New England game, too.
Yeah.
And then Atlanta went up 28-3.
When Atlanta puts that last touchdown on the board, using 25 points, that's four scores.
Yeah. And then New England goes down. They get the touchdown.
Yeah.
Gostkowski. You remember what he does?
Shanked it.
Yeah.
Hard.
So it's 28-9 now. Then they do an onside kick, which at the time I thought was the wrong decision.
I think I thought it was the right decision.
Okay, but do you remember? Okay, Gostkowski did not have himself a good game. Do you remember what he did?
Oh, he touched. He touched it before it went 10 yards.
So it is 28-9, and Atlanta has the ball in New England territory.
Hold on, I want to talk about that onside kick for a second.
Okay.
Because a lot of teams onside kick, they line up like two guys on the cover side on the opposite side.
Yeah.
They line up the kicker in the middle, and then they line up the other eight guys on the one side to make the rush. Right.
Yeah.
I love the Patriots onside formation. It's they've got equal numbers on each side, and they wedge it in the middle, and it forms a wedge.
Well, if the guy didn't touch it, you know.
No, I know, but that form. But see, because the problem with a conventional onside kick is you've got eight guys going at eight guys, and it's just too many guys in one spot. The Patriots split it up; it forms a wedge, and you can get guys in there cleanly. I think that's actually going to become the predominant play type for future onside kicks. Teams are going to look at that and say, wow, that works great as long as the kicker doesn't touch it.
They might have could have had it if he didn't touch it.
It was close. He touched it at like nine yards.
So this time it's 28-9, right?
Yep.
Atlanta in New England territory.
Yep.
Flub it. Screw up.
Yep.
New England gets the ball back. I think it was that drive. They get into the red zone and they still can't get a touchdown.
Yeah.
So it's 28-12. And in my head, I'm watching the game. I'm seeing the score 28-12. I still think New England's outplaying them.
Oh, I thought
28-12, and they were the better team.
I thought New England outplayed that whole game.
I did too.
But when you're like, if you're looking at a conventional game, right? People think of 7 points as one score, but technically you can say 8 points is one score because you can go for two, right?
Yeah.
So when you're down by 25, though, that's four scores, like four full scores, even like you have to go 8, 8, and 8, and then get the ball back and get a field goal at a minimum, right? So I was thinking, like, that four is, like, three touchdowns is a lot. And then to get three and get the ball back while holding the great Atlanta Falcons offense to no points, I mean, I thought it was too much. So,
and that, to settle for the field goal there, I still, okay, they're down 16, but they shouldn't be down 16.
No.
That's what I was thinking.
Yeah. And, well, but, and then here's the
thing. And then, sorry, 20, oh, no.
Here's the other thing, right, is if Atlanta, after they get 28, right, if Atlanta puts up any more points, even a single field goal, it's over. Yeah. Like I realize because they can't tie the game. Even the Patriots can't tie the game if Atlanta puts a field goal.
Right.
So it's like completely over.
And we could talk about the TSN turning points, the big momentum shifts. The one where I think most people are going with 28-12.
The grass catch, right? No, that's later in
the game. That's later. Yeah. I'm talking about the strip fumble.
Yeah.
Dante Hightower.
I want to hear this one. Talk about it.
So Matt Ryan, I think, played a great game. This is one
I think he played a good game.
Good game. We'll go good. I can see that.
You lost, so I'm not giving you great.
He gets the... This is one thing people can't fault him on, this fumble.
Yeah.
Freeman just takes a nap, whatever.
Yeah.
Hightower just beats him.
Yeah.
And it wasn't even, he didn't do a move. He didn't shimmy. He ran right by him.
Freeman completely missed his blocking assignment.
And he rocks Matt Ryan.
Yeah.
And then they get the ball. Plays later. Danny Amendola is in the end zone. And now we got ourselves a game. Now at that point, I'm like, it could win.
It's on.
Yeah.
And you know me, I love my blocking.
Yeah.
Right? I'm not all about that fancy plays.
So Freeman would not have been in.
No, Freeman would be in my doghouse. And I'd be playing Tevin Coleman a whole lot more.
Tevin Coleman got injured.
Yeah, I know.
Yep, that's...
But and so it kind of forced Shanahan into playing it. And they had never played a one-back system all year. They had been floating two backs back and forth all year.
Yeah.
But you know me. I always talk about, like, whenever I see a sack play, I was trying to figure out which guy missed his blocking assignment when the center calls it out.
Hey, well, do you know who we could give some negatives to is that New England O-line to begin the game.
Oh, they were...
Grady Jarrett?
They were...
Three sacks.
Sebastian Vollmer was a little shaky, too, I think.
I don't think he played. Wasn't he injured?
Vollmer was on the left tackle. Okay. Oh, yeah, he was there.
Yeah, they did not...
They were a pretty bad O-line in that first quarter.
It was giving me nightmares from the 2016 AFC Championship game where Von Miller just...
Yeah. So now I want to talk a little bit about. I think we've covered
wide receivers. Do we hit Edelman again?
We've hit Edelman again.
Edelman.
He's a product of Tom Brady.
No, he's sure, but he's more than that. Oh, okay. One facet of the game New England put Atlanta to bed in was special teams. How many times did Atlanta try to bring it out and get stopped at the 10?
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah. I didn't see this, but someone told me, or I heard it,
yep,
that Bill Belichick was going running down the sideline when it was 28-20, and he told Edelman, fair catch it.
Yep.
He wanted to conserve all the time in the world. He wanted to put the ball in number 12's hand.
Yes,
and
I would too.
Yeah, but they're smarter than everybody. They are.
Well, do you know that? Do you know what? So what college team does Bill Belichick most frequently draft from?
There's a few. Alabama.
No.
Rutgers.
I'm making a smart play here. He drafts from a smart school. Harvard.
He has a few from Harvard. I don't think they're the most, but yeah.
No. If you actually break down the Bill Belichick drafts from the time he's hired at New England in 2000 there till now, the school that he has most frequently drafted players from.
Yeah, I wouldn't have got that.
Is Harvard.
But they do have smart players. They have situational football.
Because Bill Belichick likes smart players because smart players can run the... And this is what I love about Matt Patricia, is he doesn't play some base defense that's bland and vanilla. What is Matt Patricia known for? He's known for his exotic blitzing and complex cover schemes. And so you need smart players who can understand those schemes and those systems. And so you got to draft guys who are smart.
And since you just talked about Matt Patricia, time to give Josh McDaniels some love.
Yeah, oh, man.
Yep. He, I don't know if it's confirmed, but I believe he turned down the 49ers job.
He did.
He
did.
The guy is, first of all, do you want to go coach the 49ers? Good luck, Kyle Shanahan. Good luck. But Josh McDaniels, I hope they're kind of trying to groom him to be head coach one day, but when's Belichick going to leave? We can't push him out the door.
He's leaving on his own terms.
Yeah, but Josh McDaniels, for him to just say, no, I'll come back to New England. I'll come back.
Well, the thing I think about Josh McDaniels is he got hired by the Broncos in, like, what, 08?
Yeah, he stunk. He stunk there.
He was with the Patriots, then he left the Patriots to be the Steelers, the Broncos head coach.
Just like the Patriots, win. Sorry, Trevor.
So he left the Patriots to go be the Broncos head coach for a few years during the Tebow era.
And apparently he was pushing to get Tebow.
Yeah, and then that whole plan went south, and he's back with the Patriots. And I think he's just really comfortable with where he's at, and he's not quite ready again yet to take another head coaching job.
I forget what year that was. Maybe around 08, 09.
Yeah.
Josh McDaniels, actually, the first time they played, Bill Belichick, New England's Belichick.
And McDaniels Broncos,
Broncos won.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Do you know who was the Broncos quarterback who he beat the great Tom Brady with?
Oh, it was Kyle Orton, right?
It was Kyle Orton.
Oh, my God.
So, he started off really good, but
It went downhill quickly.
And he actually had another stint with the Rams. He was an OC before he came back to New England.
Right.
New England had Bill O'Brien as their OC.
That's right,
And him and Tom Brady did not get along.
All right, so let's quickly move to some stats here because I love my stats. So, first downs. Who do you think won first downs?
New England murdered them. It was I don't know for sure. It had to be the most lopsided ever.
New England had 37.
9?
Atlanta had 17.
Okay.
So that's 20 that's more first lot. Down. That's all. That's huge.
This game went to overtime.
Yeah.
Overtime.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, overtime wasn't really that much of an overtime.
Do you want to talk OT rules later?
We'll get to that. Okay. We'll get to that. Because I got a sore throw with that. Yeah. Okay. Third down efficiency. So New England converted 7 for 14. This is the game-changing stat.
1 for 8.
One for eight.
And Matt Ryan was money all playoffs.
Yep.
He picked apart the Legion of Boom, or the Legion of Boo-Hoo, as I like to call them, and Green Bay. Okay, Green Bay's defense is hot garbage, but he picked them apart.
Hold on. Say that again, and then give me the credit for what I've been saying all year about the Green Bay defense.
They're garbage. They're garbage.
And I'm taking all the credit on that one.
Okay. Will you give them some credit? They did have some injuries, though.
Not on defense.
They were running no cornerbacks. They had no cornerbacks. No,
they've got Ha-Ha Clinton Dix.
That's it.
And then their like top corner is Gunter.
He's brutal.
That's your top
Logan
corner.
Logan Ryan is Darrell Revis of old compared to him.
There are kids who play like for the Mustangs in Winnipeg here who are better than Gunter.
He's brutal. But again,
and Gunter, if you see this, I'm sorry, but like you're trash.
So let's go back to that 1-for-8.
Yeah.
Most of the times they were throwing, I believe, on those third downs.
Yep. But if you want to win the Super Bowl and be an elite top three quarterback in the league, 1-for-8 is not good enough.
It's hot garbage. It's pathetic.
I mean, the Patriots are only 50%, but they're not like 12% here.
Yeah.
Like that's really
and
terrible.
And that was Atlanta's money coming in. And you think a team like Atlanta for third downs, they have so many weapons.
They have Julio Jones, Mohamed Sanu, Taylor Gabriel.
Sanu got shut down.
But so those are the three big receivers. And they got Austin Hooper, who's at any moment can be lit up for a game.
They throw to their fullback probably more than any team in the league.
They have more weapons than you can imagine on that offense.
And usually they have Coleman and Freeman, who can both run and catch.
Yeah.
And for you to go 1-for-8,
Matt Ryan
has to take that a little bit.
Yeah,
he needs to own that a bit.
He does.
Yeah.
And I know people say quarterbacks get all the praise.
Yeah.
But you know what? I like to give them all the blame. If you're going to take all the praise when your team wins, then you've got to take all the blame when your team loses, because you touch the ball on every play.
I'm the worst Brady fanboy when it comes to that. When he wins, it's all him.
When he wins, you say it's all him, and when he loses, it's never his fault.
Sometimes it is, but a lot of the time it isn't.
But I'm the voice of reason, and if you're going to take all the credit, you're getting all my blame. Matt Ryan, you got to step it up.
He does.
Fourth down efficiency, the Patriots are 1-for-1. The Falcons are 0-for-0. They didn't have a fourth down.
Amendola was clutch too, wasn't he?
We've been over this. rushing yards.
They tied, right?
They did. They 104 tied. Yards apiece for rushing yards.
I don't know if this was the longest run for New England, but there was I think it was still 28-3. It could have been third down. I'm not sure. Brady rattled off a 15-yard run.
It was Tom Brady with the longest rush.
It was for them.
It was,
man.
Yeah. I'm looking it up right now. Yeah.
Well, Blunt got nowhere all game.
The second longest rush for the Patriots. Hang on a sec. I just had it. Was James White? Deion Lewis with 13, and then James White with the 10.
Did they have? They had five people with a rushing attempt that game.
They did. Yeah. Blunt, White, Lewis, Brady, Edelman.
They did. They ran them out of the jet formation there.
Yeah.
The game.
Way to cite the jet formation.
Yeah.
Passing yards, 442 for the Patriots, 240 for the Falcons.
Again, passing yards is a lot. Sometimes they're the most overrated stat because you could be getting pounded.
Well, it could be garbage time stats.
That's not garbage time coming back from 25.
Well, it was kind of garbage time. But they turned it not into garbage time. They turned it into mattering time.
Yeah.
Total yards,
and
546 for New England to 344. Now, in the last 4th-and-1, I talked about how terrible the Falcons' defense was. They were 28th in the league this year for pass defense.
Would have not expected that in the first quarter, how they were balling.
They weren't. Yeah, exactly.
They were fast. That's what I noticed.
Dan Quinn, who was the DC for the Seattle Seahawks when the Legion of Boom first came about.
Yeah.
And he was the DC when the Patriots beat them in Super Bowl 49.
And let's not remember, Super Bowl 49, I keep going back to that game, but it does have relevance. Yep. It was 2 years ago.
Yep.
Patriots picked that team apart.
They did.
Super Bowl 49.
And so to start the game, it appeared as if Dan Quinn had done his job and game planned it so that his very weak defense could keep Tom Brady under control. But I think as the game went on, it really showed that defense is not what it needs
to be. They also got gassed out. We could give them that.
Tom Brady kept them on the field, and then because they were on the field so long,
couldn't get pressure.
They're not what that defense needs to be yet.
And if you would have told me someone's going to sack Tom Brady 3 times, Vic Beasley?
Yeah.
Nope, this Grady Jarrett?
Yeah.
If Atlanta wins that game in overtime or whatever, it might still be Matt Ryan MVP. Who knows?
Yeah.
It's probably Grady Jarrett.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, for sacks.
A lot of sacks this game.
There are 10 total sacks. Five for each team.
Okay. Yep.
And here's the important part. The Falcons had five sacks that lost the Patriots 24 yards.
Oh, New England's would have way but more.
The Patriots had five sacks that lost the Falcons 44 yards.
Do you have who had the sacks that game on there?
Give me a second. I can pull that up.
I know Hightower had a big one. Trey Flowers was money that game.
So Trey Flowers had 2.5.
2.5, okay.
Hightower had one.
Sheard? Jamal Sheard?
Sheard had a half, and Branch had another half.
Alan Branch, okay.
Yeah.
And again, we talked about him. Chris Long was getting pressure that whole fourth quarter.
Yes.
Yeah.
Interceptions thrown. I mean, one to nothing. Yeah. For
maybe could have been 2-0, but that
here's another stat that just shows the dominance of this game. The Patriots had four punts for averaging 41.5 yards.
Yeah.
Falcons had six punts averaging 47 yards. Two more punts. That's two more drives you had to give up on.
And again, the special teams, not just. Take the punters away. Just the return game in general, New England crushed them.
Yeah. Penalties. New England 4 for 23.
That's small.
Yeah, that's very disciplined.
Atlanta, they didn't have many, did they?
9 for 65.
Okay, that one drive was three of them.
Yeah.
The holding call to end the game.
Nine penalties.
Yeah.
Things that are keys to any football game is turnovers and penalties.
And there was one they probably got away with right at the beginning of the game. I was screaming at the TV. They rocked Edelman out of bounds.
Yeah.
That's called nine. Come on, you got to call
it. I kind of feel like the penalties that the Falcons had offset with the turnovers the Patriots had. Because in my mind, the two most important factors in a football game are penalties and turnovers.
Oh, right. And
so if you have two turnovers, but they have nine penalties, to me those are
the big penalties again with the holding call.
Three straight holding calls. Three straight
plays.
And again,
that ended on a pick six. So whatever.
Yeah.
But the holding again on Chris Long.
Yeah.
And the PI on Martellus Bennett. Mm-hmm. To be fair, it took away a touchdown. Probably he would have caught that.
Yeah.
But it set him up at the 2 yard line. They're gonna score. They're not gonna pull a Bevel. What's it? That idiot's name?
Daryl Bevel.
They're not gonna pull that. They're gonna put it in the end zone.
Exactly. Each team had one fumble and one fumble lost.
Blunt and Ryan. Right?
Yeah. Now, and I know, I wonder if Luke's watching, because I know he used to be a really big Chip Kelly fan, and Chip Kelly doesn't believe in time of possession, but...
Chip should.
looking at this, he should, because time of possession in this game, Patriots, 40 minutes and 31 seconds.
Again, what is...
Hold on. And the Falcons had 23 minutes and 27 seconds.
I know we talked about them, why there might have been reasons not to run Freeman. I give you that.
Yeah.
Except on that last drive. But again, the one thing is inexcusable. When they were hiding the ball with 20 seconds left on the game clock, the only rational explanation, I thought maybe they thought they had the Patriots gassed.
Yeah.
But they didn't because they've been on the bench the whole game.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Those guys are not gassed.
No.
Why are you...
The TOP is almost... Is actually almost 2-1.
So there's like a Bermuda Triangle of blame right now, and I don't know who's responsible. Matt Ryan.
The blame is falling over the part all over the place, and I think
Ryan Shanahan Quinn.
I think it goes to the GM. I can't remember. Is it Griffin?
The Canadian dude.
Yeah.
Dimitrioff or something.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think you have to start there because he's the one who drafts the players, and his defensive drafting hasn't quite been there.
Okay, but I'm talking.
But I'm saying. The blame is all over the place.
Okay, but he also built a team that went to the Super Bowl.
Hold on. I'm saying the blame is all over the place. I'm saying that team needs to take like an organizational and a foundational look at how they do things and their culture and how they approach things. Because there are so many things that went wrong that you can't have go wrong.
To blame the GM for a team who gets the Super Bowl.
I'm not blaming him solely,
but
I'm saying like, you know, we're going to go Dan Quinn, Matt Ryan, the GM.
But again... Why hitting the ball 20 seconds left on the time clock?
Yeah.
In that instance, who is the one who's telling if Ryan's doing that on his own?
Then they need
then Quinn has to get on him. If
they need some law and order.
If Shanahan is doing that, Quinn has to get on him. That's why Quinn is at my number one. That's his fault. Then it probably goes Shanahan, Matt Ryan. Flip those two around. But at the end of the day, those two, Ryan and Shanahan, if they were doing it on their own, that's up Quinn.
Yeah, but see, here's the thing. Dan Quinn's a defensive genius, so they say.
Yeah.
Genius.
Yeah.
You got lit up at 34. I don't know if you call that a genius.
and Super Bowl 49.
And
lit up.
Well, yeah. But Super Bowl 40. Okay, we'll leave that one aside.
Yeah.
Because he doesn't. He wasn't calling a lot of plays in Super 49. That's Pete Carroll calling defensive plays there.
I think, maybe, but Quinn knew what he was. Quinn was a big man.
I think Quinn's a game planner there in Super 49. But in this one, Dan Quinn has to be on that.
Yeah.
Like, you can't let them hut the ball. Like, take a knee.
If you've ever seen some players' stock and coaches' stock go down after Super Bowl performance, Cam Newton was one of them.
Yeah.
I don't think Matt Ryan went down as much as Cam Newton. Because Matt Ryan, he still played. We said he played good, right?
Cam Newton had a fumble that he didn't jump on. Ryan didn't.
You know what Cam Newton should take a video of? Or take look at the video? Julian Edelman diving for that ball.
Yeah.
Cam Newton, I'm still not over him because Cam Newton's god-awful performance gave Peyton Manning his second Super Bowl, which he didn't deserve.
And it gave so many Peyton Manning fans the ability to say, Peyton's so good.
Peyton's got two. Garoppolo's got two. So
okay, settle down there.
So, okay, we were talking about stock falling.
Yes.
Matt Ryan's stock fell a little bit, I think.
I'm not so sure that his stock fell unless he's the one who's freelancing those plays.
But if a guy's stock ever fell, from where, even coming into this game, no one was really talking about Dan Quinn. They were talking about Kyle Shanahan.
They were.
His stock has fallen
a lot.
Yeah.
Although,
now you're going to go work for Jed York. Have fun.
Hold on. But a lot of people are going to chalk that up to, well, he was just distracted
Then that's a horrible. Then that's more reason to be mad at him.
You can't be distracted.
Yeah.
You're in the Super Bowl. It's only the most important game of the year for your sport.
Yeah.
Right? You cannot be distracted. And now you're leaving the offensive Ferrari that is the Atlanta Falcons. And you're going to the Chevy Cavalier that is the San Francisco 49ers.
Let's just...
And I'm not even sure it's a Chevy Cavalier that's got an engine in it.
Let's take a little tangent here. If Shanahan's... We talk about...
Yeah,
who is going to be the QB for the 49ers? I heard two names that he's targeting.
Let's go for it.
Kirk Cousins and Jimmy Garoppolo. Any chance any of those two kind of work out on the 49ers?
I don't see either of those guys going to the
49ers.
If I'm Jimmy Garoppolo, I am
begging Belichick, do not trade me there. Don't do it, Bill.
So let's look at each of those individually, right?
Yeah.
So for Jimmy Garoppolo to go anywhere, the Patriots are going to have to trade him.
Yeah.
Okay. So what I've heard, the asking price for Jimmy Garoppolo is 2 first round picks.
They won't get that.
The same thing that Sam Bradford was traded for at a minimum.
Yeah.
So, according to, apparently, the Belichick will only trade him to a non-AFC team. So you're looking at the Bears. Because I've heard the Bears are interested. And they have a really great first-round pick.
I'd maybe rather go after to the 49ers than the Bears.
The Bears and
the 49ers. The Bears are hot garbage.
I think the Bears have more to work with than the 49ers.
That is picking between just... that's bad.
Which piece of garbage would you rather eat?
And later we'll get into the Patriots offseason. I'll get into some Garoppolo.
So then, Kirk Cousins. He's not going anywhere.
You don't think so?
You like that?
I don't think he likes Washington. I think he feels a little disrespected there. But again, Kirk Cousins, is there ever a guy who has highs and lows, though? I don't want
But if you look at Kirk Cousins' stats, it's not like Mount Everest and the Marianas Trench.
He throws some horrible... He's Eli Manning-ish lately.
He's not that bad.
Okay, but like they had a... That was a must-win for them week 17 or against the Giants. If they win, they're in. And just that pick he threw to end the game. That's one play, but my God.
So here's why Kirk Cousins isn't going anywhere. So they used the franchise tag on him last year because they said, okay, you've been our quarterback for a year, but we don't know, we don't want to commit to you long term, so they franchised him, right?
Right.
If they franchise him again, he'll eat up 25% of the salary cap, and they can't afford that.
Yeah.
But they can put the non-exclusive franchise tag on him, so his tag will go up a little bit, but not to 25% of the cap.
Yeah.
All right. And the thing is, with the non-exclusive tag, other teams can field offer sheets to him, and then the Skins would have a chance to match that.
Right. So they might almost want that.
Right. So no one's gonna. He's not going anywhere because any offer sheet you'd give him would have to be above the non-exclusive tag. So you're gonna be giving him like 19% of your team's salary cap.
So what I got from all of this, the 49ers are boned.
They're going to be starting Colin Kaepernick next year.
They are just horrible.
I
there's some horrible franchises in the league. I think the Bears are horrible. They're horrible.
The quarterback, if the Niners are not starting Kaepernick or Blaine Gabbert next year, They're starting Tyrod Taylor.
Right.
Because the Bills want him out of there.
This is for a different podcast.
Bills management wants EJ Manuel.
Oh, God.
Bills ownership, the Pegulas, they want EJ Manuel. But I guess we can wrap up the game. And I just want to say a couple things here.
Number one,
I'm ecstatic that New England covered. That won me like a whole bunch of bets.
I love how they were, the beginning of the playoffs, Trent Dilfer said, I will take the Patriots in every game. I'll take the six or whatever.
All the points.
And they ended up doing it. And he's like, oh, I told you, Trent, they won in overtime. But still, he's technically
correct. But they covered.
He's technically correct.
Yeah.
And the one thing, where does it rank for the greatest Super Bowls of all time?
See, here's the problem. We're not really old enough to know some of those like early Super Bowls.
Okay.
So I'm going to say
all the ones
Super,
that you've watched.
Super Bowls in my lifetime,
it's
top three.
See, again.
It's the stats that have come out of this game are mosts and firsts.
Yeah. And again, Patriots fan bias, but the top two Super Bowls of all time could have been the Patriots' last two wins. Like, seriously. Those games were just unreal.
See, but I know that I'm like the people that I'm the football person that people hate because I like good defense. Do you know that in 43 out of 51 Super Bowls, the better defense has won?
Well, if you want to talk about it,
I like to look at I'm not opposed to watching great defense.
If you ever
like people hate Floyd Mayweather. But I love him because he's a great defensive boxer. He can get away from punches.
If you want,
and I like seeing good defensive football.
If you want an entertaining Super Bowl, you want the New England Patriots to win it. If you want to talk defensive, what was their best Super Bowl they played in where like defense dominated? Their first win.
Against the greatest show on turf, the Rams.
Marshall Faulk's still a little salty about that.
All right, so I know you want to talk about some Patriot offseason stuff coming up.
Should we get it? Yeah, we'll do that, then we'll get into the Brady legacy. I gotta hit that too.
All right, let's go.
Which one do you want to do
first? We'll start with free agents.
Okay. So at the end of the 2014 season when they won it,
right?
Their roster was trimmed a bit.
Sorry. I just remembered one thing.
Yeah.
Before we close out the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
This is
a halftime show?
She
rocked it.
She went. Lady Gaga was fantastic, and I'm not even a huge Lady Gaga fan.
No, she was great.
It was
amazing. I was so depressed watching that because they were down 28-21.
But it was such
it a brought good, me up a bit.
You know when she was singing on top of the stadium there?
Beautiful.
And there was the red and white and blue lights behind her?
It was
her?
Awesome.
Hold on. Do you know that those were drones?
I actually kind of heard that.
They had flown a whole bunch of drones up there to have the lights
before
behind
before Lady Gaga hijacked this conversation, you were...
Okay. Gronkowski.
Oh, yes. Let's save it for the off-season talk.
Hold on.
Okay, we can start with them.
A lot of people in recent past have questioned Tom Brady's ability to win without Gronkowski. No Gronk?
Yep.
It fully cements that, and you can tell everyone, look, Brady can win without Gronk or without Gronk, and it doesn't matter.
And the one thing I'll say, a lot of people are saying, oh, let's trade him now. I'm going to tell you why they're wrong about that when I get into their offseason.
All right. So let's
start.
Now I'll let you go into the offseason.
So 2014, they won the Super Bowl. They beat Seattle. There was a few tough decisions. They let Shane Vereen go. And I remember at the time, I'll be honest.
To the Giants.
Yeah, I didn't like that. I'm like, oh, Vereen, he was so good.
Yep.
And then people were like, well, so was Danny Woodhead. So was Marshall Faulk.
Yeah.
But I said, Vereen's different. He's better.
Yeah.
Deion Lewis is better than Shane Vereen.
Yeah.
And James White, he had the big game.
Yeah.
All times you better than Shane Vereen there in that We're not sure yet. But the fact is, Belichick looked at that. At the time, James White was on the roster still.
Yep.
He was a bench player, more or less. And then they plucked Deion Lewis out of the sky.
Yep.
So Shane Vereen goes. Vince Wilfork leaves. We all saw that coming.
And I thought at the time, I thought that was too early to get rid of Vince Wilfork.
Yeah, but the New England Patriots had some big free agents at that time who, at the time, it looked like they wanted to re-sign. They had Chandler Jones and Jamie Collins. And we both know what happened to them. They're bye-bye.
Yeah.
So anyways, but the big decision for the 2014 offseason came between Devin McCourty and Darrelle Revis.
Yep.
I wanted both of them. And, like, in hindsight, they made the most perfect decision.
Yep.
But you've got to remember, Revis was money in 2014.
Oh,
money.
He was worth every dollar they ever paid him.
Yeah. So they chose McCourty, which was good because McCourty's great.
Yep.
So, that team got purged a little bit. They probably still should have won in 2015, but they had so many injuries. Denver was the perfect storm to beat them. Again, I'm biased. You hate this. But they were...
You can't say that. Denver had a defense that that may be better than the 1985 Bears, which is like regarded as like the greatest.
If you want to go back to that 2016 AFC Championship game, New England lost 20-18 and they missed an extra point.
But if you want to talk about the top five defense of all time, it's like the 85 Bears, the 11 Seahawks, the 2000 Ravens, and the 2015 Broncos. Regardless,
the Patriots could have won that game. And they had a lot of injuries that year. But so, my point is this 2016, this team is going to be purged more than the 2014 team.
Who's out?
I'm going to tell you some of these free agents and which ones I think what their game plan is going to be.
All right.
Hold on here.
So,
So, the big one, right off the bat. So, when I said McCourty or Revis, right, they have something like that this year, but there's more of them. But the big one is Dante Hightower and Malcolm Butler.
Oh, you keep Hightower for sure.
I'd say over Butler. But New England is a little willy-nilly with the franchise tags. They franchised a kicker. That's completely different because you're not paying them a ton.
Well, no, but the way the franchise tag works is you have to pay the person the average salary of the top three salaries.
So doing that to a kicker is...
Kickers don't make money, exactly. So the average of the top
they
three
They usually
is
don't do it with position players. My thing is you're going to have to do it with this year. I want them... This is my person. You go... You sign Hightower to a long term. You do it. You did what you did with McCourty. You sign them. They're worth it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you franchise Butler? I say yes because it's 1 year. Okay. It's 1 year, right?
Yeah.
And Butler is a good cornerback. He's not great yet. He's good.
You're not sure yet if you want to commit
to him. I want to see one more year.
Yep.
But again, so Butler and Hightower, I think they'll keep both of them.
Yep.
Two players I think that are gone who are pretty vital. When LeGarrette Blount led the league in touchdowns,
that was
his pink slip out in a way because they can't re-sign him.
Oh, hold on. I know one. That's 18 touchdowns.
Yeah,
LeGarrette in a 16 game season.
He will not be back next year just because.
Ooh, that's a big one.
Just because they won't be able to re-sign LeGarrette Blount. No way. They could find some team's gonna pay him.
I want to point out though that the Patriots have an extra $19 million in cap space that Tom Brady doesn't use, where other quarterbacks would use it.
Yeah. So again, look at these free agents. So Hightower.
Yep.
Butler. Blount. And Martellus Bennett will not be back next year. I'd be shocked. I would like him back, but he had a good year.
Yeah.
And here's why I'm saying Gronkowski is going to be back. Do you know, out of every tight end in the league, what number highest paid tight end is Gronkowski? Is he the highest paid? Is he the second highest paid? Is it, what do you think he is?
I don't even think he's in the top 10.
He's the fourth highest paid tight end. So, Gronkowski, injuries aside, when healthy, he's a bargain. He is a bargain. Injuries aside.
Well,
fourth highest paid tight end. He's the best tight end in the league.
Okay, if you're looking at it like that, then yes, he's a bargain. Okay.
So I think you take Gronk back.
Yeah.
Bennett, if Bennett wants to play under the same contract he did this year, by all means, bring him back. He ain't going to do that.
If he wants a raise.
He's going to get a raise. He is.
It'll be tough, though.
Yeah.
But I want to point out, for many years when they had Aaron Hernandez and Gronkowski, the Patriots really loved that double tight end set.
Hernandez was still more explosive than Bennett was.
He was, but Bennett is capable of running that double tight end set.
And Bennett can block. He's a great player. He fits New England system great.
Yeah.
I just don't think he'll be back. And then look at these pass rushers. Sheard and Long are both up. And Allen Branch. Those are three good players.
So
they'll be lucky to get one of them back.
So I'm looking at Long. He's old.
Yeah. Played under one-year contract.
See, if I'm him, I could retire because now I've won a Super Bowl.
Yeah.
There's nothing else to play for. Why wreck your body? You've been paid.
Probably, yeah, sure. But if he wants to come back and play under the same contract, New England would be stupid not to take him back.
Oh, of course. Oh, yeah. But, yeah.
But again, so even though Chris Long might sign cheap or whatever, they got to sign these other guys we talked about.
Now,
so he might just be gone out of not because we don't want you, but because we got to pay these boys.
Now, I think the thing you're missing here, and I'm going to see if I can Google this real quickly, is the New England Patriots cap space. And what is their...
I forget, it's not a ton, but they have some guys who might take contract cuts or reduce their contracts. Danny Amendola does it every year. He might have to again, especially since Malcolm Mitchell...
is coming up. Well, no, but he's a rookie this year, right?
Right.
So they've got two more years.
But I'm saying Amendola, as great he was... in the Super Bowl, he is about their number three or four option, and he's not paid like a number three or four option.
All right, so the they're going to have a rollover cap of $5.9 million in available space for a total cap space of... they've got about $40 million in cap space. And that's not a lot. That's like two and a half to three players. Four if you get them all on really good deals.
And again, so Jabal Sheard, he's probably going to go.
Yeah.
I would like to see Chris Long back. Alan Branch, I would really like back.
Yeah.
And then we talked about, so Malcolm Butler.
Yeah.
I think he'll be back.
Mm-hmm.
But they don't have that many good cornerbacks. Eric Rowe is about their number three. Logan Ryan, also a free agent. I know he's my whipping boy. I would like him to re-sign.
I love how he's like your least favorite player on the team, and you want him back.
I do want him back.
That's that same way like I want Matt Asiata to re-sign with the Vikings.
Yeah. And who's the other one? We got most of them. And talk about, so Jimmy Garoppolo. Let's go to him. The only thing I would take for Garoppolo is a first rounder. That is what I want.
Well, apparently the asking price from Bill is two firsters.
I think that's insane. They won't get it. I even think asking for one first rounder. Just here's what you look at. Look at these quarterbacks who are having... not everyone's a Dak Prescott.
I'm the Atlanta Falcons. I lost.
Dak Prescott went, what, fourth round?
Fourth round, yeah.
Jacoby Brissett went ahead of him.
Yep.
Like, so if you think it's a heavy cornerback draft...
But it's not.
It's not supposed to be. But again, you are taking such a risk with a guy like Garoppolo. I think Garoppolo's good. I think he is a good quarterback. And that's why I would want a first round for him. If you can't get that, I would rather keep him.
So how's this for a trade? And hear me out on this one. I'm working this out here. How do you feel about a first plus Joe Hayden for Jimmy Garoppolo?
Oh, I would take that. Oh, 100%. Yeah.
Even though Joe Hayden had a down year and he's probably
not. Oh, Hayden. I was thinking Joe Thomas. Hayden I would still take. He's Joe a cornerback still.
Even though he had a down year and he's not as fast as he used to be.
He probably has a heavy contract. He has to have a heavy contract. Yes. Yeah, probably not then.
But then you can draft Jalen Hurts. Who was the Heisman from Louisville this year? The quarterback?
Oh, they didn't draft the quarterback.
Hold on. You take him first overall and you develop him under Tom Brady for three more years?
No.
How does that sound?
No, I'd rather them just keep Garoppolo, honestly. Yeah. Think about Jimmy Garoppolo.
Because you just have to work out the trades. Like, if you're going to trade him to Cleveland, right?
Yeah.
What are you getting from... what are you getting from Cleveland now?
Cleveland had more than just a first overall, though. I don't even think they'll want to part with the first overall.
No, but... Well, you're not trading him for their second round pick.
No, they have, like, two first rounders. I think they're 1-12.
I know, but they're not trading either of those.
So, Jimmy Garoppolo. This is a guy... He is not just, like, some free agent they picked up. They drafted him in the second round.
Yeah.
So for the Patriots to draft a quarterback when they have Brady in the second round, they value him.
Yeah.
And just, again, look. So Garoppolo got picked in the second round.
Yep.
Wilson got picked in the third. Prescott got picked in the fourth. I'm not saying they're equal, but what I'm saying is
coming into the draft,
Garoppolo was valued higher than these guys.
Right.
So to say Garoppolo is just a throwaway player is a joke. Because he played really well in his two games.
So here's where I look at it, right? So when your team's starting quarterback gets hurt, a la the Dallas Cowboys, right? And then you start Dak Prescott and he turns into like the bucket of gold at the end of the rainbow.
Yeah.
Right? And then you got Tony Romo healthy again, right? You look at, okay, that instantly gives the Dallas Cowboys the best number one and number two quarterback in the league. So you don't have to worry about if one gets hurt, can the other play, right? Yeah. So now you go through the league and think about, okay, well, who has great backup quarterbacks? Well, really, it's...
Not many.
It's the Cowboys and then the Patriots.
Patriots, yeah.
The Patriots would have...
They have a solid backup.
They would have probably the top three.
Yeah, I can't really see another one jumping out right now. I'm doing a quick run through the teams. I can't think of a...
Like no team really has...
Yeah.
Great backup quarterback play. And so if Tom Brady, God forbid, were to get hurt in a preseason or like the first few games of the season, right? The Patriots don't have to worry and they have that safety net in Jimmy Garoppolo.
Yeah.
Right.
And not only that, I know what did Brady there's rumors Brady's gonna sign a 3-year extension.
Three to five.
Let's just say three for I think that's a fair that's not out of the world crazy. But to even convince Jimmy Garoppolo to stay for 3 years, his contract's going to be up. He could...
Well, he's got one more year.
Yeah. So, Even so three at the most is a lot of asking your backup to...
Well, no, patient. He has to be there for one.
One, right.
Right? And then you have to convince him to stick around for two more.
And maybe they start thinking, well, maybe Brady will miss a game here, there.
The way that Peyton Manning and Brock Osweiler shared
something
it.
Something like that. But do you think Brady's going to do that, be down for that?
I think he would. If he wins a sixth Super Bowl.
But if Brady is still playing at a high level,
yes.
I think even coming from me, it would be a little crazy to expect him to do this for another 2 or 3 years.
He actually posted on I think it was on Instagram that, so Giselle, his wife, Giselle Bundchen, the supermodel,
wants him to retire.
Once it said, if it was up to her, he would have retired
the
minute that game ended and he won.
Yeah.
And he said, he actually told her, sorry, babe. Yeah. I'm having too much fun doing this. As long as I can still do this at a high level, I'm going to keep doing it.
So, again, he's the greatest of all time. That's pretty much sealed. But right now, I still truly believe he's the best quarterback in the NFL right now. We can talk about that. Aaron Rodgers, I think Brady's ahead of him. So, if you, like, he's still the best right now. So, you got to roll with him for this year and next.
Yeah.
I think for sure. And I hope you could sell that to Jimmy. But... If you're offered a first rounder for him right now and a high first round, I would do the trade.
Here's the thing, because you also have Jacoby Brissett as a safety valve.
We don't know what we're getting from him. Let's be honest.
You don't, but he's still a good safety valve. He performed pretty well in the one game that he played.
He played the game they beat Houston. He won. That was on Blunt's back for the most part. He played well, but then against Houston, and then he stunk up the joint in the second game. So.
But, you know...
He ain't going anywhere, though. He's going to be the backup or the third stringer next year, so...
So, and I guess now you want to talk a little bit about the Brady legacy?
Sure. We could get in one thing before that.
Okay.
The Brady-Rodgers argument, to me, is silly and ridiculous.
Okay, we'll save that for another podcast.
Sure. Yeah, because this is about the Super Bowl, Aaron Rodgers hasn't got to since 2010. Give me this.
Settle down, you Patriots
since
fan.
Since Aaron Rodgers won his first Super Bowl, where he had all the luck in the world, Tom Brady has been to three and have won two. And, like, come on. And Rodgers, how many...
Enough about gassing up the Patriots. Like
when you do your preseason podcast, I want to get in Rodgers.
This will be an off-season discussion. We're going to have this, for sure. Yeah. Definitely.
Do you know a Packer fan you can bring over here?
I do know a Packer fan.
Okay.
Yeah. So now, Patriots legacy.
Yeah.
The Steelers are the only team in the NFL to have six Super Bowls. The Patriots are now tied with the Cowboys and the Packers.
Niners.
The Cowboys, Packers, and Niners.
Aren't the Packers five. Not for Super Bowls, though?
No.
NFL champion.
No. The Packers have five Super Bowls. A bunch of them, I think three of them came.
I think they have four.
No.
Could you Google that?
One's Favre, one's Rodgers.
Two Bart Starr.
Double check. Okay.
I think the Packers have four. But let's just start. So six to Steelers, right?
Six to Steelers.
Four with Bradshaw.
Yep.
Two with Roethlisberger.
Yep.
Yeah. And they've been in the eight, I think, Steelers. I think they're 6-2. They've lost two that I know of.
Okay.
Could have been more. But for all-time dynasty, so we're talking about dynasty right now. The Steelers, they have 4-2. Those are completely separate teams, right? The 49ers had five relatively close together, relatively. They had the four with Montana, and then Steve Young came in. No team has done what New England has over a period, what they have done. They've had 5 in 15 years. That is the best dynasty in sports.
Okay, so the way it works here for the Packers, so they have one, they have two from pre-merger that are
NFL
also... No. So they have... 11 NFL championships.
Yeah.
But then after it's still pre-merger.
Yeah.
Where they have two AFL-NFL Super Bowl championships.
Two? They won Super Bowl one. Okay. Oh, did they win Super Bowl two as well?
Okay. In 66 and 67, they won the AFL-NFL Super Bowl championship.
Yeah, that was Super Bowl one, right?
Right, but those are technically pre-merger.
Yeah.
But those are still considered Super Bowls.
Right.
And then they have two post-merger.
Yeah. Okay.
So four... technical Super Bowls.
That's what I... Okay.
But
again, New England is the only... Again, Brady has five.
Yep.
No one else is that. But those five were in one era. The Steelers are split. They had four and the two.
Yeah.
The 49ers, four and a half... 'cause they had two different quarterbacks to get it done.
Yep.
No team has dominated...
the way the Patriots have.
And again, New England, they lost two Super Bowls. That doesn't go against them in my mind.
The only team I can think of that like rivals them is, say, like Jordan's Bulls, where they won three straight, and then Jordan took a break and they came back and they won three straight.
Yeah, okay. But for NFL, it's the Patriots.
I can't think of another team that's been...
Yeah.
In the NFL, there's no team that's been as dominant. And I'm just trying to think in other sports... Like
The Oilers in their heyday, and the
Yankees.
Yeah.
Pretty much every other year.
Yeah, and recently, not as big as New England, but what the Blackhawks did there, 3-6.
Well, but if you want to talk about 3-6, that's also the LA Kings for a short
stint. 2-4.
2-4. Yeah. So I don't really want to include the Blackhawks just yet.
But again, and then, so New England Patriots.
Yeah.
What they did is incredible, but what Tom Brady has done, it's unreal.
As a sixth rounder too.
Sixth round, 199 overall. So we talked about, five Super Bowls in seven appearances. They lost in the AFC Championship games before, just really close games.
Yeah.
Denver beat them twice, and they lost to the Colts that one year.
Hold on. Don't tell me you're trying to tell me that his stats could be that much more.
They could, though. But again, they've won some games they could have lost, but they lost some games they could have won.
So my point is
consistency. He's been there.
Yes.
He's always there. Every year... When we do our pre-picks, I always pick the Patriots, of course.
You do.
I have about a 50% chance of being right about them getting to the Super Bowl.
Yeah, I think you have more than that. Because in the AFC, there's not that many. Like, Denver's still got a great defense, but their offense isn't there.
When we do,
Kansas City doesn't move the ball.
When we do a preseason podcast.
Yes, we'll get there.
Yeah, just what no team right now jumps out in the AFC.
In the AFC, people think the Steelers can't.
Steelers, they'll get.
But no, but they can't.
That's their biggest competition.
But I don't think that is.
No.
The Steelers have, zero. Yeah. The Steelers have no defense.
Yeah.
And I'm, James Harrison is 37, I think.
Yeah.
And he's their top defensive player. But, he can't. How many more years can he play? He can't. And in the NFC, I think the NFC is the better
conference. Oh, it is.
I think the NFC is the better conference right now. But in the AFC, Denver's offense isn't there yet. The Brock Osweiler is trash.
Since this was a Super Bowl podcast, we could probably... Let's talk about the losing team for a sec. Atlanta, next year, do you think... What do you expect more? For them to be closer to what they were this year or closer to what Carolina was this year from falling off a cliff? Somewhere in the middle or what? This is a fair question.
I don't think they're going to fall off the way Carolina did, because Carolina was...
They went 15-1.
15-1, and then they went 6-10? I think it was 6-10.
Yeah.
So that's a tremendous fall off. Atlanta this year was 13-3?
11-5, I think.
11-5.
And then the two again, but let's be their two playoff wins,
yeah,
blowouts. And they beat they smoked some good teams.
Well, okay, but the Packers weren't that great, I don't think.
But still, I'm just saying they blew out two teams.
They blew the beaten Dallas.
No,
they didn't beat Dallas.
Green Bay and Seattle. And they blew them both out.
But Seattle traditionally on the road under Pete Carroll is terrible on the road.
Sure, but what my point is, Atlanta, they were good this year. And what do you think, if you had to project, what are they going to be next year?
See, but here's their problem, right, is they need defensive pieces.
Yeah.
Right? And they need to go in free agency and spend money on the defense. They need to draft well. And here's the worst part, right? Because they're the loser Super Bowl, they're gonna get the 31st pick.
Yeah.
Right. So their first round pick isn't gonna be that great.
And
not that he's not gonna be great, but it's just that it's not a transcendent prodigy type player like the Browns are gonna get.
And the one thing the way they lost, we probably didn't even address that enough. They lost. That is the most heartbreaking probably Super Bowl loss ever.
Yeah.
It is. Oh,
at
horrible.
28-3, you're. People are thinking you're a loss.
Like, Carolina, they had a bad loss just because they were embarrassed. They didn't show up.
Do you know...
They stunk up the joint.
Do you know, at 28-3, the live betting odds on the Patriots coming back to win?
I forget. Sergio, I was watching
the game with the buddy. It was paying 11-1.
I only had the cojones
to actually put that down.
Yeah, or the money to put that down.
I mean, pre-game, the Pats were the favorite, and then... Well, a favorite nonetheless. Right? And then in the middle of the game, they're 11-1 underdogs.
Talking about a little Super Bowl prop here. The minute I knew the Falcons were going to lose, when they selected to wear the red uniforms. You wear white? Do you know what stat
I'm referring to? I know. The teams that wear the white uniforms win
12 out of the last 13, I think.
Yeah.
The last colored team to win it was Green Bay when they wore green.
Yep. Back to fancy stats for a second here, though.
Oh, you don't like my colored stats?
I don't like your... I
like the Patriots white uniforms.
I'm not picking Super Bowl winners based on colors here. Just like I'm not taking the team with the better Gatorade.
But I'm telling you, when I found out the Patriots were wearing white against Seattle and white against Atlanta, I was happy. That's so weird.
That's a good omen.
It is,
It's a good omen, but I'm not betting money on them.
Before you get rid of my colored thing, do you know Denver last year, they had the choice what to wear, and... You know, usually the home team wants to wear home.
Right.
They elected to wear their white jerseys. Yep. So one team was buying in. Denver was buying in.
Okay.
Okay, sorry. Go to your stats and ignore my
color. So do you know the stat win probability?
Like, who has... Atlanta's...
Your chances of winning at any given moment of the game.
Atlanta's highest at one point was 99.2. Was that their high, the ceiling?
You're wrong.
Higher?
It's higher than that.
Oh, my God.
So, at the start of every game, your win probability is...
What was it before the game?
Before the game, because the Patriots were a little bit of a favorite, it's right around there. To start the third quarter, the Patriots had a 0.5% chance of winning.
To start the fourth quarter.
Start the third.
The third was only 21-3.
I know.
Oh, that seems a little high at that point.
The Falcons were, to start the third, 99.5% to win.
I don't know what that math. That seems too high. Like, 18 points is like...
No, but based on the math and
if
and
it how, got to 28-3, I would say, okay, maybe.
But it sat there because you can't really go lower than that. Like, the math won't allow you to go less than that. So they had a 0.5% chance to win the game to start the third quarter. And then... a couple drives happened, and you can't really go lower than 0.5%. That's like the minimum we'll give you, and it's like our pity give you for like we'll give you 0.5%.
Oh, the city of Atlanta,
right, and like so like you, people don't understand. Well, maybe they do, but I'm not sure they do. People talk about how great Tom Brady is, but he took from 0.5% to win. To actually winning the game,
he has the two biggest Super Bowl.
If you look at the graph of their win percent, it goes like this, and then it does this, and then it actually goes nearly vertical.
One of my favorite just stuff on the social media I was looking at.
Yeah,
a lot of people like just non football fans wanted Atlanta to win, and one of the reasons was. Politics a little bit. Trump liked the Patriots, right? People wanted them to lose. And I could see why they wanted to lose. And one of the best parts was Atlanta Falcons were the Clinton campaign. And Patriots were the Trump campaign. They both did one of those, right?
So now that the Super Bowl is over, do we get to have a protest? Because that's not my Super Bowl champion.
Do it all you want, man. They're mine.
Not my champion?
I think Tom Brady's going to go to the White House this time, though.
Well, Martellus Bennett said he wasn't.
Devin McCourty also said he wasn't.
Yeah.
And before, like, I was going to be like, oh, that's selfish. You should just suck it up. When Obama was in Brady.
Okay, let's not get into politics here. This is a sports podcast.
But
if you want me and Elliot...
Politics should stay out of sports, then.
No, but it's a tradition that you go to the White House.
No, okay, but like
every champion from every sport goes to the White House.
My point was a lot of people were cheering against the Patriots because of that.
Well, I know some people were cheering for the Falcons because they like all the rappers coming out of Atlanta.
Yeah, and for the one third party fan who was going for the Patriots, a lot of it came because they hate Roger Goodell.
Okay, so
let's talk about that.
That's okay. Hold on, Okay, now, what have you done now? You've got me all excited.
He is the worst sport.
So I'm not a Patriot fan. I like the Vikings. I've been to see the Patriots with him. I put up with his Patriot garbage a lot of times. And a lot of times he's blindly trusting in Bill Belichick and Tom Brady.
I do question Belichick.
You question Belichick sometimes.
I question Belichick more than I question Brady.
And a lot of times I'm the opposite side of every argument we have.
Yeah.
And I like the Vikings. I just want to clear this up. I like the Vikings.
Yeah.
I despise Roger Goodell.
Yeah.
Hold on. Who's a worse commissioner? Gary Bettman or Roger Goodell?
I think Goodell still, but like Bettman's bad.
Bettman does things that are actually like against the fans' wishes. Whereas Goodell is just the person who has to wear the negativity of the fans.
Yeah.
Right?
And just like I find Bettman's even a little more on it. Like, even when they were interviewing Bettman about going to the Olympics,
yeah.
he straight up says the owners really don't want to go. They don't see an upside. Yeah. That's greasy, but it's the truth.
Yeah.
Roger Goodell just flat out lies to people.
Yes.
And
yes.
everyone knows he's lying, and
yes.
he won't admit it.
Yes.
Again, when he refused to go to Gillette.
Yeah, for 2 weeks, for,
yeah.
for the 2 weeks of the playoffs
yeah.
there, he went to Atlanta twice.
Yeah. And then how he didn't show up for the season opener of the 2015 season when they were
yeah.
defending champions.
Yeah.
Didn't go. And he just refused to acknowledge that he
yeah.
wasn't going for Deflategate.
Well, okay.
It was always an excuse.
At the I saw an interview with Roger Goodell
yeah.
From Friday, the Friday before the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
And they asked him, so do you think it's going to be a little awkward if you end up handing Tom Brady the Lombardi Trophy after Deflategate? And he goes... No, I would love to hand him the trophy.
On
I
your
mean,
BS meter, that ranks pretty high, right?
My BF meter, like, broke
yeah.
when he said that. I was, and it was awkward. Like, Belichick and Brady got on the stage there when he's presenting the trophy to Kraft.
Yeah.
And there, you can see in the photo, right, when Roger is handing the Lombardi trophy to Robert Kraft.
Yeah.
Brady and Belichick are laughing in the
yeah.
background. And you can clearly see that it's just like...
the best part when... Goodell's, he has the trophy, right? He's
yep.
talking. You're Kraft, I'm Goodell.
Yep.
He's talking. You
yep.
could just see Kraft smiling on the
and,
inside.
And,
his tail was wagging
so,
if he
so,
had
so,
one.
So Robert Kraft, Bill Belichick, and Tom Brady.
Yeah.
I think this season, and I've said this the whole season, this was the Tom Brady FU tour
yeah.
towards Roger Goodell. Tom Brady is fueled by anger and hate. Like, he
yeah.
could be the next Darth Vader.
You saw his commercial, right? The first
the
one.
Roger that. Yes.
That was great.
Yes.
But, like, and Robert Kraft.
Yeah.
As soon as he got the microphone, he
acknowledged Deflategate.
Yeah. He didn't say the words. He didn't need to.
Yeah.
He gave it to Goodell.
He did.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, but
and,
like,
and he should have. He should have.
Tom Brady is so fueled by his
yeah.
hate of Roger Goodell. He could be the next Darth Vader.
And everyone's like, oh, Brady handled it with class. He did. He shook his hand.
Well,
but you just knew. He hates this
so
guy.
There was another pregame interview I was watching. It was actually on Sunday.
Yeah.
And so people had been interviewing Brady's dad a couple weeks ago.
Oh, he's outspoken.
And Brady and Brady's dad said what Tom Brady says. They're both called Tom Brady. It's
yeah.
Brady
Tom
Senior, Brady
yeah.
Junior. So what Senior said was, you know, what my son says behind closed doors to family is not what he says to the public.
Oh.
Tom Brady Jr. is just more classy than everyone
yeah.
else.
Tom Brady Sr.
So,
have you just...
Hold on.
Yeah, okay.
So then they asked Tom Brady, so is your dad telling the truth here? Like, do you really say things to your family that you don't tell us?
Yeah.
And Tom Brady, he answered it with so much class and so much grace. He goes, I can't speak for my dad.
Yeah.
He's clearly a guy who loves his son. And, like, I love my dad, but he speaks for himself. And, you know, I would just rather not talk about that.
Yeah.
We're focused on the game. And, like, way to deflect the question.
Yeah.
And you can totally tell that behind closed doors, he just sits there and mutters to himself, like, I hate you, Roger.
Yeah.
I hate you, Roger.
Did you see before the game? I sent you the link. I
yeah.
know you did.
Yeah.
Who his hero was.
Yeah.
You could just tell him and his dad.
They are so close.
Yeah.
It's so amazing. Like,
yeah.
And the Super Bowl was the first game that Tom Brady's mom got to see this year.
Oh, yeah. Because
she's sick in hospital.
Yeah.
And it's so unfortunate. And it's such a great story. Now, here's the thing. If I'm Tom Brady, I would retire now. Hold on.
I get it, but he's still the best at what he does.
Hold on. He may be the best,
yeah.
but no one will ever match him. He's the only quarterback to get 5 Super Bowls.
Yeah.
Only one other quarterback has 4.
Yeah, 2. Bradshaw and Montana.
Okay, 2 of them have 4.
Yeah.
Okay, so no one will ever come close to
yeah.
your status.
I agree.
You can leave.
Ooh, yeah.
as Okay, so...
He could leave, yeah.
Hold on. Will anyone ever catch Wayne Gretzky?
No, nothing.
Never. He is now the Wayne Gretzky of football.
Yeah.
No one will ever catch
there
him.
There is something...
Why should he keep playing?
There's still some Manning records that they don't really matter, but Brady theoretically could still get. He could get the passing yards, maybe. That one's going to be tough. The touchdown pass one, I think he's on pace to break. But okay.
But what's the point?
Putting that aside, A, I still think he's the best at what he does right now. And just
But here's what I'm saying. Okay, so but what's the point of keeping playing? Okay. Before this Super Bowl,
yeah.
you could at least have a discussion about who the best quarterback of all time was, right?
Yeah, I still was on
right?
Team Brady for that.
You were on that,
yeah.
but you could at least have the discussion, and there was the possibility that you could come to the conclusion where he wasn't.
Right.
Right. That doesn't exist anymore.
Yeah.
He's the greatest of all time, And he'll never be caught.
But no player has ever gone out this on top. And I know you're going to say John Elway. When John Elway won that Super Bowl, he wasn't even the best player on his team still.
Elway, right, but so this is what I'm saying. So Brady has the ability. Right, because hold on. What if Brady comes back next year and he stinks up the joint the way Peyton Manning did?
It would suck, but...
Right? Yeah. Right? Why not go out as the greatest of all time and you know you'll never be caught? Never, ever, ever will you ever have another quarterback.
I just follow... They are so close together, this team. Like, Brady's best friend is Edelman. They hang out all the time. Like, these guys...
So then, become an offensive... Become fun. You know, become assistant OC to Josh Daniels.
That's not going to happen. You know I'm not going
to...
I know.
Yeah. But he's got nothing left to play for.
No, but... Like, 6 is better than 5. Like, I'm just saying, this team is not quite done yet. Like, their Super Bowl win, I still can't...
Like, they should have been done 10 years ago, though.
This team, they'll be favored... I'm not saying they're going to win it next year. They'll be favored. I think they are the favorite.
They already are opened up as the favorite to win next year.
If I had to bet right now, yes or no, would they win? Like, that's the field against them. I'd probably go with the field
always take the field.
You've got to see how... But just on paper, again, we talked... They're going to get purged this year. They're not... I'll say this. They're not going to be as good next year as they are this year. That's just a fact. But... Right now, the NFL, we'll talk about this more on the
next podcast. Yeah.
It's just, there's not that many teams right now that are scary.
Right.
Yeah.
But you've got nothing left to play for. It's like asking, like, why does Jaromir Jagr keep playing?
Because he loves it, man.
But he has nothing left to play for. Yeah. Right? It's the same question. And I think we'll end it there.
Yeah.
We can both agree, greatest of all time, never, ever going to get caught.
Never.
No one will ever, unless like, I don't know, like, who's the backup in Cincy there behind Andy Dalton, the former...
A.J. McCarron?
Yeah. Unless like A.J. McCarron gets traded to like the Niners and then all of a sudden like gets hit by a bolt of lightning and becomes like some like Superman. It'll never ever happen.
Just last point. Tom Brady retires, who do you think is the next kid coming up who potentially could be him? The guy who's going to end up with the most Super Bowls. Is it Rodgers?
No.
Who would be next? And Andrew Luck's great. It's probably not him. That's what I'm saying. People, just watch this. You're never going to see it again.
From left field, Blake Bortles. Just kidding. I know that's
it. Appreciate greatness. You could hate the Patriots. If you're not a Patriots fan, you should hate them. I hate the Chicago Blackhawks.
I think it's,
appreciate them.
I think it's a little better for the... Not that I'd kind of like to see him retire and go out as like the on top as he could possibly be. But I think it's a little better for the league if there's more parity.
This is going to be my final take. This is the last thing. Me and you, our generation.
Yeah.
We never got to see Wayne Gretzky play in his prime.
No.
Crosby's good. Sackett, they were not Wayne Gretzky.
No.
We never got to see Michael Jordan play in his prime.
No.
LeBron James is great. He's not Michael
Jordan.
Let's not
get into that.
Okay. So, but we are witnessing Tom Brady play. We witnessed him in his prime, and it's been fantastic.
It has.
Thanks for having me.
All right. So this has been the 4th and 1. Remember, like us on YouTube and subscribe to us on Facebook. And Tyler is a Patriots fan. He may end up becoming a semi-regular guest host here.
Only if they're winning.
Only if the Patriots are winning. Anyways, this has been the 4th and 1. Remember, like and subscribe on YouTube and Facebook.